lectures. Thank you for coming along. My name is Alice Long, and I'm working the outreach team here at BSMS. Before we start this evening, I just wanted to give you a few more dates to your diaries. You probably picked up a few leaflets in the foyer, but just to let you know, the next of our lecture series will be January the 8th, and it'll be at the slightly later time of 6:30 to 7:30. And we've also got a Christmas lecture coming up, which is for students aged 8 to 14, and that'll be looking at global health and Santa's Christmas journey around the world, and that'll be on the 13th of December. And you can find information about all of those on our social media channels. And now allow me to introduce our speaker this evening, Professor Malcolm Reed, who is the current Dean of Brighton Sussex Medical School. Malcolm Reed qualified in medicine from the University of Sheffield in 1981. Following postgraduate surgical training in the UK and a period of research at the University of Louisville in Kentucky, he returned to Sheffield for higher surgical training. He became senior lecturer and honorary consultant in 1992 and was appointed the foundation chair in surgical oncology at the University of Sheffield in 1999. He was appointed as Dean of Brighton and Sussex Medical School in December 2014. In 2016, Professor Reed became the chair of the Medical Schools Council Education Subcommittee, and then recently, in August 2019, he was appointed co-chair of the Medical Schools Council. He has a long-standing track record in cancer research with more than 300 publications. His main current areas of clinical research relate to the surgical management of breast cancer, with particular emphasis on breast cancer in older women. So please, let's welcome Professor Malcolm Reed.
Before I get going, because I'd like this to be interactive, because if it's not, it's not going to last terribly long, I'm just going to invite you to find someone sitting near you that you don't know, and just chat to them for 1 minute about why you're here, what you're thinking about. Go for it. I'm not going to start getting any better. Don't be frightened to get up and walk. God, you'll have to walk and talk to this guy here. That's my laptop. So, given the nature of this talk, who do you think those people are? So they're there to remind me on a daily basis that my dad, who is still alive, my mum died a few years ago. Guess how old he is there? How old is he now? About 21 and about 19. He's an Australian pilot. She's the first girl in Birmingham as far as I can tell. So that's why I'm here. That just sets the scene. His father also joined the Australian Army in the UK, but went back to Australia. They went back to Australia after the war and then came back here. And there he is now. So 97, smiling dementia, hasn't really got much of a clue where he is, but he's happy and safe and warm. And the other people who live in the same nursing home just up the road in London, Guildford, love him to bits, and the staff love him to bits, because he's cheerful, he's lucky. He's got a kind of dementia that leaves you cheerful, rather than a kind of dementia that leaves you cross and more difficult to deal with. He's easy to deal with for the start. Nearly died when he was about 23, still here at 97. People born in this generation would have had a life expectancy, would have been predicted about 70. So the world has changed in his lifetime from, you know, no electricity as a kid, going to school on a horse, to where we are now. That will happen again for the next generation, and again for the generation after that, but you shouldn't be frightened of that, because he, you know, people worry about the future. Intelligence and all the genomic revolution, how are you going to cope? Well, they didn't even have electricity. It's not coping with these changes. People do cope really well. I don't worry about that at all for the future. I worry more about people who can't change, really, you know, because they're stuck in living in the past. So this is my early days. This is feedback circa about 1963. Does anyone get feedback like this on their school work? Yeah. Does anyone remember this sort of feedback? It is absolutely shocking, isn't it? Oh, sorry. What have I done? Try again. It is absolutely shockingly bad, that, isn't it? I think I was probably 5 or 6. I mean, goodness knows, it's awful. I wouldn't have given this person any chance of doing anything, really. I can't really read it. Look at the handwriting of the teacher, I mean, it's just amazing. It goes on. Oh. 4 out of 10. There's another one, which is something like 7 out of 32. But then again, I've got a bit of good feedback. I don't remember this at all. I came across this when we were clearing my dad's house because we sold it recently. 1965, there you go. Won a World Cup. No, I like that. Well tried. Slightly better. That's the only positive one in the whole exercise book, I have to say. I think I was really particularly dense because I don't remember particularly having a bad time at school or anything at all, really. I just wanted to go. And so I suppose the question is, how do you go from that to this? And it's no great miracle. And, you know, I don't think for 1 minute that every doctor has to dress up like a Time Lord. try and read 200 names out without getting too many of them wrong, which happens to me every year. But it's great. It's great. There's obviously a bit to fill in between there and this. And this is a slide I prepared earlier for a talk I did when actually we were talking about, I talked about PhD students on that particular day and what happened, but we just had to give a bit of time frame. And the only reason I chose this as a background slide for here is because, as we did in the south, we just don't know what snow is. Mm-hmm. Whereas I was in Yorkshire for 40 years, and this was probably a mild day in June, to be honest. We used to get snow like this every winter. So I just put that up just for the sort of effect of seeing snow and trying to prosecute the daily life in that. So I'm happy to chat about any one of these things, but please feel free to ask questions. In fact, I might just throw it over to you, and based on what's on that slide, or based on anything you'd like to know, you can feel free to ask me a question or two now. So I'm just going to ramble on for now.
What made you choose oncology?
And what made me
Actually, I'm sorry for that. It's a great question. There was a questionnaire as well. I might just pick that up if I can at the same time.
At what age do you feel the medicine is appropriate for you?
Okay, so the two things kind of go together. When I was about 12, my grandmother came to a school, my grandmother must have been in mid-80s by that time, came to a school fair at Christmas, you know, the kind of thing. Fell over, broke her hip, broke her wrist, and had an operation. This was in the 1960s, so hip replacements were really brand new then. And looking back, someone in their mid-80s in those days having a hip replacement was really pretty much cutting-edge stuff, actually. Not only was the operation new, but people who fell over in their 80s, if you don't do an operation, they mostly die. If you do an operation, about 80% of them will get through. So she did really well from that operation. But I remember visiting in the hospital a few days later, maybe a week or so later, thinking what an awful, smelly, horrible place it was, because it was an old-fashioned Victorian open wards theatre. It really was awful. And then because she inherited some money, actually, there was enough funds to move her to a nursing home to get better. And I remember thinking this is a much better place for her to get better. It wasn't fancy, but she had a room and she had a sort of care with walking and things like that. So it certainly impressed me and made me think, oh, I wonder if I might want to, you know, do some like orthopedics. I always wanted to be a mechanical engineer because my dad was a mechanical engineer after a period of time after the war. And I was so bad at arithmetic and mathematics. My maths and arithmetic is worse than my spelling and writing. And I would have been the most dangerous engineer anywhere. And he said, well, what about medicine? Surely you need maths for that? Well, actually, you don't. It's a bit of a myth. You just need to be careful when you're doing sums for the amount of drugs you give to people. So if you're not good at maths, you might want to get someone to help you check that. But otherwise, you don't need much to know maths or arithmetic. Maths is quite a good subject for testing some forms of innate intelligence, because people either see maths or they have to learn maths. It's a bit like music or something. I think some people see it more easily. So 12 was when I first got interested, and then a bit of a bumpy ride, but got into sixth form, and was starting then, I think, to really progress. And I was definitely a scientist, loved biology, struggled with physics and chemistry, but just did it because you had to. And I was never going to do maths, so most science subjects are out, really. There's so much maths in nearly every other science other than medicine. Don't let me down that. I had a girlfriend who started a GP, I thought that's all right. That's about as far as the thinking went. My work experience was going to speak to our GP and say, why did you do medicine? And he said, this is an honest, true answer. He's a great big bloke. He said, well, I wanted to play rugby, my dad told me to go to medicine so I could play for 5 years. So he went to Queen's University in Belfast and played rugby for 5 years, basically. The oncology thing came later. I really thought I wanted to be an orthopaedic surgeon for a long time, and then got out of medical school and started doing surgery. And I really enjoyed orthopaedic surgery. Anyone who sort of likes cutting and sticking and banging and crashing, it is great fun. And people just get so much better from orthopaedic operations. It's a thing that has huge impact on quality of life. I've ended up having my knee replaced, and it's just transformational to, you know, not be taking painkillers and get to walk and run again. So orthopedics is great, but actually, well, I enjoyed the operating, I didn't really enjoy the clinics. And you'll spend much more time, for every operating list you do, you'll do two or three clinics, talking to people about their surgery, seeing new patients. And I just wasn't engaging properly with people telling me about back pain. Things like that. You know, if they needed an operation, I'd kind of come to life. But most people you see, even in surgery, don't end up operating on them all. So I just realised I wasn't engaging. And at about that time, I met a young woman in clinic, and this is a general surgery clinic back in the old days. This was early 1980s by this time. So she'd come along with a breast stone, and the clinic was full of people with piles and gallstones and hernias. There were no specialist nurses, so I did a biopsy and saw her the next week. I've got no training in breaking down news or anything like that, but I just couldn't trust anyone else. I did not trust. I just thought, well, I need to see this person again. You know, got to have some continuity here. So then I was talking to her the next week about breast cancer and all the issues are coming up. And I guess that more or less influenced me. I'd done a research degree, which happened to be in breast cancer, about that's what got me into oncology. Any other questions?
Why did you decide to come to Brighton?
Brilliant question. it's the best medical school in the country. Simple answer. It's absolutely fantastic. And the reason is because the culture here is fantastic. It's a caring culture where we really care about the students. We really want them to do well. It's not easy. It's not soft or anything like that. It's rigorous. But we really care about the students and their learning outcomes and their development. And we care about each other as the staff as well. So it's really just that culture that's great. It's also the only place my wife said she'd move to. That was helpful. And she'd already said that. And I said, well, there is a medical school there, but I don't think the dean's going anywhere. And then a couple of years later, I heard that actually a colleague contacted me from here and said, actually, the dean's just handed his notice. So that's kind of how it came about. I sort of got it sorted then. So for me, it was between, I didn't show any academic potential until I was 13. So I got into grammar school, as we had to do in those days. And anyone who thinks 11, well, I'm not going to ask you to put your hand up if you think 11 plus is a good idea, but I don't, because I think making a massive decision about people when they're 11, you're either good and you go on and you continue your education, or you're not and you go into vocational training. It's just the wrong age to do it. Way too young, and it's too big a blanket decision. You might say someone's not very good at science or not very good at maths, but they like to be good at something. So I'm not a fan of the 11 plus, especially as in my day we were streamed into an A stream and a B stream. I managed to get into the A stream. We did pretty much academic stuff every day, all day, and the B stream basically were playing in the afternoons or doing crafts. They weren't really being educated to the same degree, and yet there would have been a lot of people in there. You know, as we know by educational theory, because we're not, they would be dyslexic. A whole bunch of reasons why they weren't performing in tests. And doing tests when people are 7 and 8, I think, we test students to death nowadays. You lot would have had far more tests than we had. But we had this one big test at 11 that said you were either going to continue with an academic education or you weren't. So I was never a fan of the 11 plus. When I got to grammar school, they told me I was the third lowest student in the school. There were 90 of us who arrived, and they told me I was in the bottom three. I think they told quite a lot of people. Tell me. And it took me another couple of years to get going, actually. And then it suddenly clicked, and I went up into the A stream and came second or third in the A stream, and then dipped again a bit for GCSE because of all the usual distractions. And then had a similar kind of conversation going back into do A levels because I wanted to do subjects sciences where I hadn't done that brilliantly in my GCSE, but they let me. And then I got better through A levels, and that's when it sort of started to work. So that's what I mean about being a late developer.
Which is really quite late.
Yeah. Yeah, Karen.
Were you daunted by the prospect of university considering your parents or you haven't?
No, that's a great question as well. My father left school at 14, 15, narrowly missed out on a scholarship that would have allowed him to carry on. But after the war, in Australia they had a really good thing, which is returning servicemen could go into further education college. There were no universities. Well, certainly where he was in Perth. But he went to further education college and was able to do mechanical engineering off the back of no GCSEs or A-levels. He was very bright. And so he then had a very good career. So by the time I went through, we were sort of already nesting in the middle classes, he would say. And my older sister and brother both went to further education college. And then my next sister and brother both went to university. So by the time I was going to university was normal in our family, really. So no, I wasn't too daunted about that, actually. It's hard to remember sometimes these things. There was a question at the back.
Why do you have to move around so many times?
Yeah, that's a great question, isn't it? Back in the day, I never think these were the good old days, but the longest contract I had before I got a consultant contract was about 2 years. And that's just the way it was. We have much longer training contracts now. So I moved, partly because there was a number of jobs that you were networked into. So this is the thing about the question about networks, really. I didn't come into medicine with any networks. because knowing my family donors, and the schools just didn't do any of the kind of outreach and networking that they do now. But because I've shown an interest in surgery as a student, and then, you know, through dropped out of qualifying, one of the best bits of advice I had fairly early on was, you know, get yourself a mentor, get yourself a near peer mentor, someone who's a year or two ahead, who's being successful, and then have a role model that you can aspire to. I don't think the terminology is the same. That's really it. What's your aspiration role model? And, you know, who's the person you can kind of sling a hook on? And if it's working for them, it might work for you. So I did kind of, there was a kind of set range of jobs that you could go through that you knew had, the job had a good track record. So if you went and did that job, it was likely that you'd come out of it and be able to move to the next one. So it's these sort of invisible networks, which are things we want to, you know, you wouldn't support. Now, you can't take them away, actually. What we have to do, and the reason we do things like this, is to try and make networks available to everyone, so they're not hidden anymore. Just the way you do things by mentoring and peer identifying peers, identifying role models, is open and transparent, rather than sort of, when we used to use the term old boys networks, but it's not old boys anymore necessarily, but it is connections and networks. We need to make that more readily available for people. That's really, I would say, probably what we're trying to do here in many ways. I think there was a hand up. Yeah.
Is it just straight A levels to get onto the program and the education A levels and things like that?
So if you come into that, we had an interesting discussion about this morning. You can do, and I strongly recommend the International Baccalaureate, which you can do at Barnaby. Not enough people are doing that. It's a really good setup. A levels are the standard, probably, way in if you're coming in from school. And there are other options where we can include BTEC as well. So we need chemistry and biology A level, and we need good passes in that. But the third A level and or BTEC and or other things there's a lot more flexibility out there than you would think. About one in three of our students coming in this year have already done a degree somewhere else, and that can be in a whole range, it can be in anything. We have access students who have been out working in jobs, they might have been to university years ago, they might not have done. They might not have been, they come in through access courses, which bring them up to speed in the biology and chemistry side of things. So there's a whole much more diverse range of things than you would think. Probably just over half of our students are coming in with A levels of a fairly standard set of biology and chemistry, but the other half are very much more mixed. We'll look at something else on there then. Yeah, so I did an what they call an intercalated degree, which is taking a year out during the course to study a subject in more depth, and you can get a degree, usually a BSc, right on that. I ended up doing one in breast cancer, so that looks like that was a really clear choice in my career. I knew where I wanted to go, actually. I went away on a summer holiday thinking I was coming back to do some research in blood vessels. And when I got back, the pathologist who I was working with said, I've got a much more interesting project for you, do this. And I did that, and it was a year of resilience training, basically, because not one single experiment worked in the whole year. And so I wrote one of the thinnest theses of all time, because I just could describe the background and the model and all the different ways I tried to make it work, and it just didn't work, actually, which was a bit disappointing. My supervisor managed to work out why it didn't work, and so he published a paper which he included me as a secondary author on it, which was good. And we worked out why it didn't work, and it was fairly obvious, actually. The thing that we were looking for, these are pathology slides of breast cancer specimens, and the thing we were looking for was getting washed away down the sink right at the beginning of the process. So he realised that might be happening, and washed it the way you do with these specimens. You have to wash them to make them sort of not react to him, really. And he took the effluent of that and tested it and found all the estrogen receptors we were looking for were basically going down the plug on. So it was good to find out that was the cause of it. And that did get me interested in breast cancer, but at that time you couldn't specialise in breast cancer treatment. It was part of general surgery, so you learned how to deal with that, as you learned how to deal with stomach cancer and rectal cancer and hernias and gallbladders and hiatus hernias and a whole range of stuff.
because you wanted to help people, or were you just interested in the science behind it?
Yeah, to be honest, I don't think I thought about it that much at the time. I think this is going back 40 odd years or more. I honestly can't quite remember what I thought. I remember thinking, well, I'm interested in biology. I don't want to do just biology because I couldn't see a huge range of options for that apart from being a biology teacher. Because nobody really sat down and said, well, if you do biology, you could do research and you could do science. And medicine just seemed like a good fit, to be honest. To be honest, at that age, I don't think I was really thinking about helping people, if I'm completely honest. I think it kind of goes without saying, I'm sure I would have answered the question, why do you want to, I know I asked the question needs to be, why do you want to do medicine, why do you want to come to this place? I know I would have had answers to that, although we didn't do any interview preparation or training, I just literally walked in cold. So I think I learned about helping other people much more when I started to do it. It's quite surprising, but a lot of it you kind of learn from experience. Everyone's going to say that, I'm trying to be completely honest. And I was really interested in biology and I was really interested in the science to some degree at that time. The reason I did an intercalated degree was because the course was very stale. The curriculum hadn't been modernised or modified for 20 or 30 years. It was really quite disappointing for the first couple of years. So the person I did the intercalated degree with was a really quite inspiring teacher. I was just finding pathology quite interesting at the time, so I thought, well, I'm going to have to have it. You know, I actually thought to the point of being a bit fed up with it. I thought, well, I'm going to have to do something to make this seem more interesting. So I asked him if I could do a degree with him. At the university at that time didn't do any collected degrees in pathology, but we managed to put one together. And I enjoyed it, even though the experiment didn't work. I just enjoyed it. And he learned a lot about research. There's far more stuff that doesn't work than does in research. So I qualified in 1981. I did what we used to call house jobs in those days for the next year. I then went back to Birmingham contractor where I was taught anatomy there for a year. And then went to Bristol for a year and did casualty and orthopedics. I went to Derby for about a year. Did surgery. Went to Birmingham for a year. 18 months and did many more surgery and then went to Louisville. And this is the days of networks I was talking about where there were these invisible networks because I just got a phone call from a professor one day and he said, a friend of mine in the States who's a very influential surgeon has got a research job, do you want to go? And I said yes before I knew where it was because that's what you did, you know, you went to America. And it was great. And the same wife who said she'd only move to Brighton was okay going to Kentucky, so that worked as well, I was quite lucky with that. And that was a really enjoyable experience. I loved living in the States. I would not practice medicine in the States for anything in the world at all. Healthcare in America is desperate for that. Yeah. I can go to mine if you want, but I don't need. A really good question. I've always been quite lucky. I always love what I do, whatever it is. But I haven't put the dates on here particularly, but that appointment to a consultant there was 1992, and moving here when I really changed was 2015, so 15 odd years doing the medicine surgery bit. I was doing academic work as well, but 2 days a week rather than doing more now. So I did a lot of, I trained to do something. And then when I got there, I made a conscious decision that I'm just going to do this. Because as I said, every contract was 6 months, a year, 2 years. And you get used to this, right, what next,
very good. There'll be people here who've got particular skills. I mean, I sometimes think about, you know, being with someone who can say you've got this form of breast cancer or whatever else it is. It is a moment of crisis in that person's life. There is absolutely no doubt about it. And without being in any way complacent or smug or anything else, being the person that can help is a real privilege. And it's good. It's very upset. I can help. You know, we have done this. We know what to do. So you're just picking someone up more than you want. And actually, it's like when the plumber comes in, when you've got water coming through your ceiling, to be honest. They're calm, they come in. I've had this situation. I drilled a hole in a hot water pipe. And I then put my thumb on it, trying to seal it, and I just ended up with a very red blister of thumb. And the emergency plumber came in and he said, oh, I'm lucky, I've got my drill hole hot water pipe emergency repair kit. And he pulled out of his pocket a screwdriver and a Phillips screw, slightly bigger size than the hole, and screwed the screw into the hole and said, I'll come back on Monday. But he was calm about it. He wasn't patronizing. He was very supportive. He said, happens all the time, you're not the only one. You know, I can help you with this. I don't want to trivialize either his job or mine, but it is that having the knowledge and skills to help. Well, very different, because it's different now to what it was 10 years ago. It's totally different to what it was when I qualified. So definitely very different. I think if you'd said 15 years ago the NHS would still be heavily dependent on fax machines, people would have said, surely not. Surely it must have improved by then. Or if you said 20 years ago the NHS won't have a comprehensive IT system that talks to each other, people would say, oh, you're joking, aren't you? When you go into any shop, there's an IT system that underpins the whole thing. That means that you don't have people do sums and, you know, the whole thing's automated and barcoded. We're way behind that. So I think a lot of ambitious projections for the future, the NHS is a bit immune to quite a lot of that stuff. I do think medicine in 20 years' time will, at the core, be similar. I think you'll be doing that thing of asking people what's the problem, asking them to tell you more about it, and then thinking about what it might be and what are the right tests to find out and what to do to help. I honestly think the core of medicine will stay at the core of it. But the ways in which you can help and the tests that you do and the drugs that you can use will change beyond recognition from what we do now. So being able to put a heart valve in someone through a hole in the groin is just something I wouldn't have thought about. But you know, if you're asking about what they call laparoscopic surgery, which is really use telescopes and instruments, small instruments inside someone's body. If you try and do that, I'm hoping that will be completely redundant shortly, because it's like old-fashioned puppets kind of thing. And then you're looking at a TV screen, it's all in 2D. Whereas the new robots are just absolutely fantastic. Any of you that do any kind of gaming, and particularly 3D, will take to robotic surgery quite easily. Whereas people the generation above are going to have to learn that. And it is much more straightforward. So I think there'll be a lot more diagnostics close to where people live, a lot less coming to hospital to have your tests, a lot more effective drug treatment options, a lot more devices and kit to help us do things. I think the big thing about genomics is, I think there's a revolution to come that's much more exciting than the genomic revolution. It's called epigenetics. So it's the regulation of the genome. If you imagine, the only analogy I can ever think of is when you see a recording studio, you see four guys making music, and then you see the big console in the control room. They can change the sound of that completely, take two of the instruments out completely, or boost things up. That's a bit like the epigenetic regulation of the genome. And to be honest, most of the stuff in your genome is completely turned off all the time. Only a tiny proportion is expressed at any time. The mechanisms that do that, we now sort of are beginning to understand. We're a little bit away from the drugs that can turn genes on or off. At the moment, we're obsessed with editing the genome and cutting bits out and putting bits in and repairing it. Yeah, it's a really good question. The problem with medicine is it makes you think that ill health is something that happens to other people. That's the real problem. And a bit like being a policeman, I think, or being in the army, you have to deal with that. I don't think it means you become uncaring or unmoved, but it does mean you have this ability, I think, that I don't know what the psychological term is, the ability to compartmentalise, so not to get too upset. But there's certainly things I avoided. So I used to, this sounds a bit weird, forgive me, operating on children and young people is the best surgery you can do, because everything's just the way it's meant to be. Right? As we get older, we become much more challenging to do operations on. So I could enjoy that, and I did quite a bit of that surgery, but I knew that I couldn't cope with the idea of sitting and saying, I'm sorry, your child's got this dreadful illness, and trying to deal with that. I knew that I wasn't resilient enough to do that. So I think you do take yourself away from things. It's partly this thing about the stereotypes of cardiac surgeons and neurosurgeons being these really tough people, well, to some extent, you have to be, because they will do operations where people are not alive at the end of it as a direct result of something they've done physically going wrong. And that will happen occasionally, but they do so much operating, it might be once a year. And boy, you need to be really tough to do that. So some of the stereotypes are reinforcing. People who are tough will go into that, and then they'll become more tough. And I think you can get a bit dehumanized. It's quite commonly said people work in ICU can become a little bit, you know, modern terms, be dehumanized or burnt out. But you certainly need to be resilient. It's an important part of some parts of medicine. And it's important to say as well that it's not an important part of every medicine. No doctor deals with a dead person every day. Most doctors won't see a dead person from one year to the next, to be honest. The vast majority of medicine is much more routine than that. It's not exciting life and death. But there are some bits of it where you need that. So I don't want to give the message that you need to be extra tough or extra strong or resilient to do medicine. The vast majority of it is helping people with things which are pretty routine, a lot of it. A lot of what we do is routine. A lot of it is saying, do you know what, that breast lump you've got, it's a cyst. That headache you've got, it's a strange form of migraine. It doesn't mean you are ill, have a brain tumor. So it's reassuring people the vast majority of the time. The thing that they're worried about is not dangerous, can be managed, can be dealt with, not exciting life or death kind of stuff, the vast majority of the time. Routine, actually. Really important that your doctor that's doing whatever it is has done it lots of times before. You don't want to be drifting off to sleep there and say, oh great, I've never said that, I've done one of those ranges. You want, you know, this is what we do. A little bit like the airline security, you know, it's routine, it's the safety checks on planes and things like that. They do them every time because they know it makes it safe. I mean, if, you know, if you're a surgeon, you can be a surgeon anywhere, really. The reason I couldn't practice in the States fundamentally is because the commonest cause of bankruptcy in America is ill health. A third of a population of 250 million are not covered with their healthcare insurance. So it's just an appalling setup to have. And from a personal perspective, the guys I work for would kind of sort of kill themselves, really. They would have patients in five different hospitals that they would have to go and make rounds on twice a day, because the hospital that the patients were in depended on where their insurance companies would allow them to go. He or let the surgeon have no choice in where these people were admitted. Even then, it's much, much more difficult. Now, you have to allow the same amount or more time as a clinician working in a clinic to complete the paperwork to claim the fee to see the patient. You have to allow the same amount or more time to do the paperwork, get the money, than to spend and see the patient. My wife is a social worker in the hospital which saw patients that weren't properly insured or had no insurance, and they were brutal about kicking them out of the hospital when their money ran out. So the social worker was really sort of clinical accountant. They, you know, they were under hugely influences what you recommend people to have done. If you do, you know, a knee replacement such as I have here, costs, you know, in the NHS costs about, I think it's about £8,000. It's a lot of money. It's about $40,000 to $50,000 for the same thing in the States. The whole thing is just hyped up expenses. No, I don't think we can say anything safe. I think it's naive to say that. It's slightly naive to say, well, we want everything in the NHS to be owned by the public or, you know, owned by the government or the taxpayer. Because it never has been. I mean, ever since, you know, drug companies always make drugs, governments don't make drugs, or they don't make the knee replacements, they don't make most of the stuff we use. So to say everything should be in public sector ownership is a bit crazy, actually. But also, I'd say my experience, governments are not necessarily great at running things either. They don't think it's the most efficient way of doing things, to say, let's get the government to do it. So there has to be a halfway house between, it's really what we would call now sort of multiple providers. There have to be multiple providers. I don't think you can completely get away from that. But the problem with a model that says everything could be privatised, or, you know, the private sector or commercial sector are much better at running things than government, so everything should be. To be frank, they're not interested in mental health care, they're not interested in low return, they're not interested in geriatrics, they're not interested in people with dementia. They just want to do the high turnover orthopaedics, eye surgery, cataracts, the stuff where you can easily make money. But if you do that, and all that money drains away elsewhere, then you're just left with the public paying for the expenses. Which is not fair on the taxpayer, because they have to pay the tax to look after all the people that the private sector don't look after. They have some insurance, and they probably have to top up as well. So the great thing about the NHS at the moment is it's actually very cheap in terms of value for money and actual cost. So we would lose it at our peril. But it does get massively overhyped at election time. You know, they say it's the only religion that everyone in the UK signs up to is the NHS. It is a bit, there's a lot of hype around that's not necessarily true. There's bits of stuff that's, you know, provided by outside suppliers, which is perfectly okay. It's not the end of the world. But there's bits where you sell off a whole service or part of the country or a hospital and that company goes bust. This comes back to the fact. Yeah. I don't know how the time's going, someone needs to give me a 5 minutes.
When do your students tend to get off the
I actually, I can't answer that accurately from here, but the figures are overall, and I think it's true here as well, that about a third of students will stay in the area where they graduated. About a third will go away and come back, and about a third will go away and stay away. That's generally what we see. So a lot of our graduates now are in the region, which is why that's why you put a medical school in these days, because you're in an area. This is the thing that surprised me the most. When you come from the north to the south, you've had your whole life the north-south divide shut down your throat, told how great everything is in the south and how rubbish it is in the north. And then you find actually that's not completely true. You know, if you're a social worker or a teacher or a policeman and you're looking at buying a house in Brighton compared to looking at buying a house in South Yorkshire or West Midlands, well, you get a lot less house, right, for the same kind of public sector salaries. Your trains might not be high speed too, but they are better than taking you home on the way to London in the morning or trying to go across country. So there's not, it surprises me that we struggle to recruit doctors and people in a place that's as good to live as this part of the country. So having a medical school here, having a medical school in Canterbury is really good thing. And a lot of others will stay.
How many places do you want to each year to drop out there?
Say again, Steve.
How many places do you want each year to drop out there?
So we have now 200, we've just expanded to 200 students per year. The dropout rate is very low, very low. So probably 95% overall of the people who start will finish. So it's not a high attrition. It bounces around a little bit. I know it's been a bit higher this last year, but generally speaking, it's not a high attrition rate. You actually have to work quite hard to get people out of medical school. We really want people to get through. But if they're consistent, I think the way medicine gets taught is changing all the time. If you're saying, are you saying things like more distance learning?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think we pretty well every lecture in med school now is recorded and it's available online. What we perhaps would like to have is to have them available online before you come to the lecture, a bit like this, and you spend a lecture interacting and chatting and asking questions of the person to help you understand it, rather than just the delivery of information at you. So this kind of thing would be called a flipped classroom. If I send you a set of 20 or 30 slides to look at beforehand and read, you then come along and we have a Q&A session like this. But medicine changes all the time. We do categorically section here. That's not because I'm here, I'm a surgeon at all. It's actually because in many ways it's something that we still value in learning medicine. I do think that in 20 years' time, probably 10 years' time, we won't be doing cataract dissection on real dead bodies. I think we will be doing much more 3D imaging-based AI type stuff. I think we will probably, in 10 years' time, probably still have cadaveric specimens that have been dissected and preserved, because there's something quite like picking something up and looking at it properly. But I don't think we'll be asking students to do dissection in 10 years' time. We have to spend £600,000 expanding our dissection suite for the expanded number of students, but that's a good investment if it lasts 10 years. It'll still be a fantastic space. We'll probably use it for teaching 3D.
What one bit of advice would you have for anyone pursuing
So one bit of advice for medicine, I think it goes back to what I was saying at the beginning, you need to just be really interested in other people, then you'll be interested in what their problems are, and then when you've got the skills to help, it's very affirming. So just be interested in people. Yeah, my daughter's just been through this over the last couple of years. It is a bit of a marathon. And basically, it is things like this. It's things like 5 minutes university outreach programs, which are providing those networks. Some schools bring the networks in and do a better job than others. So it is about those networks. But I don't like saying things like, resilience, because honestly, resilience is what you get when stuff goes wrong. And when you're a young person, hopefully not too much stuff has gone wrong. But I suppose if you just say one thing, plugging my organisation, the Medical Schools Council website has loads of information for people applying for medical school. Medic Portal is a really good website for people applying for medical school as well. You don't need to spend hundreds of pounds on courses, provision courses, things like that. The stuff that's available for free and books that you can buy sort of second hand or on Amazon are good enough. You do not need to spend £300 going on a medicine on Facebook. Brilliant course at Nottingham called Medicine. It is £300, but you don't absolutely necessarily need to do that. So don't go spending hundreds and hundreds of pounds on those kind of things, but do use the free information that's available. I'm going to take the last two questions. Okay.
What were the most challenging aspects of your career and your speciality?
Great question. So, being in a coroner's court, that's a tough one. Being sued by people because of things that have gone wrong, where they find fault in what you've done, that's another. Those are the two toughest ones. And getting a letter from the GMC just before Christmas saying someone's made a complaint about you and they're going to investigate it, and getting another letter the day after saying you're going to be subject to a tax inspection, that's a bad Christmas. Luckily, both of them came out all right. In fact, they told me that the revenue owed me £6,000. But they said, my accountant rang up and said, it's fantastic good words. Revenue indicated that they were £6,000, but they're not absolutely certain, so they're prepared to stop the investigation now if you're prepared to accept that. And I said, yeah, that sounds like a fair deal. And the accountant said, and the other bit of news is that our fees for this will be £5,000. So have an accountant, but don't expect them back. Yeah, the GMC thing. So you will have setbacks, definitely. If you do enough stuff, there are times when it can go wrong, and we live in a world where there's a lot more scrutiny. So you can expect in your career to be complained about, to be litigated against, you need biology and chemistry, A level. So therefore you need those at GCSE. Your other A level is much more flexible, and we're happy with people doing all sorts of different things, but an awful lot of people will end up doing maths because there's a belief out there that we were having this conversation this morning with our admissions team, there's a belief out there that universities value maths more than other things. I would personally prefer people to do biology and chemistry, definitely, and then ideally another subject that's more interesting, like Spanish or French or history or art. Do you want to talk about in your interview as well? I think that's a wrap.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
That's about all we've got time for. So I hope everyone had an enjoyable evening, and let's just give a round of applause to Professor Malcolm Reed.